Hello, so this is the second layer now I've put in. Everything's in, as far as everything's had a second coat of paint. Sound like a decorator, don't I? But this is just to explain, okay? So at the moment, everything's a bit flat. And it always is at this point, because everything's just been blocked in. Right, it's pretty rough as well around the edges. But I know now everything's been orientated as far as colour is concerned, and so I can start again on the third layer. Third and fourth layer is when oil paint comes into its own, really. The sumptuousness of oil paint comes into being, so. You know, when you're in front of it, when it's finished, it really looks has this sort of dynamism, because it's got a very, the depth and the vitality, you can see it. But at this stage, it's kind of flat, and mainly that's to do with the opacity of the colour, but also the tonality. Haven't yet gone in with the secondary colours as such, and the darks and the lights particularly at the moment. So that's my next stage. So because I've completed everything now, I'll start again at the top. So I'm going to do the sky first. This sky is going to be probably, well, I want it to be a dark and stormy sky, so I'll start that. I think I'll go for manganese blue. Touch of paint's great, and touch of Naples yellow. Find it, here it is. And a touch of dioxine purple. And I'm going to use different amounts of that to create the first colour that I put down. So I'm going to do the buildings now. I've made a couple of alterations. So I did have a rock there, but it was a bit obtrusive, really, so because I needed to show a path there and the road, and also to accentuate this in the middle too, because it was a bit confusing, so I got rid of that. And also there was this line here with this children's riders I did have. It the rail coming underneath here into this icon here, but decided to get rid of that because I don't need it really, because it can come out here somewhere, so I don't mind about that. So what I'll do is I'll do this house, for these row of council houses here first. So I wanted to do these in a kind of a go for a cobalt blue. A touch of Naples. Some white. More Naples. The front has got a bit more light on it, so varying the pressure of the brush, of my my hand on the brush as I go. So that's that side. I'll the other side is further in the foreground. So it should be a touch darker in tone. Dragging the brush really.
some of those whites in there. No, I think I'll do this this man here. It's with his flat joints. So so this is now where I'm starting to look at where everything is, where. I mean, basically speaking, everything that's further back, is there's a less of a darker tone in it. Right? So the further you come, the more of a darker tone. Right? That's the basic idea. Obviously, each colour is different, and you know it's far more complicated than that. But that's the idea. So think about it. His legs are further back. His body's further forward. So although I want to darken and he's further away from this girl, see, in space. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to pick a darker colour green. Now you've got to watch as well when you put a colour down. Say I'm putting a green colour down, I've got to look at other greens, where they are in comparison in space. You know, the depth of tone. So I'm just going to pick out this now, this is sort of mid tone. Outer part of the leg. I'm going to add a touch of lemon yellow. That's the lighter tone. A bit of vitality to it. touch of the brush. I think just with highlights there, that'll be enough. So, find the shape a bit more by outlining it in the white.
Hello, so today I'm working on this side here. I've done a third layer within of all these characters within this carriage here. So now I'm doing this area, policeman sort of thing. But they're in the sort of immediate foreground, so they're going to be quite substantially dark in tone. So I've chosen phthalo blue for the uniforms. At the moment, it's quite they're quite vague, but once this goes in and I build up, they'll become a lot more deeper in tone. So. I'm going to just use it straight out of the tube for now. I'm not going to mix it with anything as yet. Obviously there might be another blue in the fourth layer on top, I don't know. But at the moment I'm working with this. So what I am going to do is add a bit of Naples yellow again, just to take the edge off the off it a bit. Bit of liquid. Again, I'm going to use the colour underneath to a degree. But I'm also going to be mindful now of this, these police lights
because I need some kind of ambience around them because they're flashing. So an ambient light or some trader description. I recently had my halfway Viva. It went okay. They said that they believe my project is viable for a PhD going forward. So I'm because I was doing the MPhil route, but they said I can only transfer with conditions, and the conditions were some revisions to my proposal, this halfway point proposal. So I've been slowed down somewhat in producing this painting because I've been doing a lot of paperwork. And revising the transfer document. So I'm sort of in the middle of that. Really, at the moment. But once I fulfil these conditions, you know, then I'll be on. Then I'll properly be on the PhD. Apparently, it's not unusual to get to this point and have to do revisions in some respect. So I'm not too worried about it. This somebody said on Facebook the other day that when they did the final thesis, it was 85,000 words. Wow. Well, because this is a practice-based PhD, it's half that really, 45-ish thousand words instead. So I've got that to come in the next 18 months, if all goes well with this transfer. All the MA students have been in as well, so it's been a bit of noise because they've got their final show coming up in September and they've had their assessments. I think there might be still a few left to have their assessments, so. But in that case, see, I don't do a video then. I just put my headphones on with my classical music to drown out the noise, and then I'm fine. I arrive here at usually before 8 o'clock in the morning, so you know, by, and I sort of split the day into sort of 2 to 3 hour chunks. You know, by the time 10 o'clock gets here, sort of half 10, I have a tea break. And then at half 12, I have a dinner break. And so on, see. So I have gaps in between. So it's good that you can do that, because it gives you time away from the work, you know, and a break. Because it's quite, well, it's labour intensive, and it does take it out of you. It's like writing is the same thing. You know, if you do enough of it, you know, concentrating hard for a number of hours, it does take it out of you. And, you know, at the end of the day, you're tired. You know, you've done a day's work. I don't understand in a lot of ways why art or a painting specifically is much maligned in that case, in that instance. You know, like, people believe, you know, I've heard it before, you know, people have said it to me, you know, oh, it's not a proper job, you know, that sort of thing. You know, oh, go and get a real job, you know, sort of thing, you know. Like you're some kind, you're like you're being lazy or something, or it's not worthy of job status, you know. But that's totally wrong. I don't know where that idea has come from. No, just because I'm not, you know, it takes it out of you in different ways than a physical job. You know, it's mentally challenging. It might look as if it isn't, but believe me, there's a, I've said it before, there's like an internal dialogue going on constantly, you know. And like I've said before, it's like a big game of chess, painting. You know, it's involving, you know, So I don't like this idea that people think it's not worthy of job status. You know, art in general is sort of seen as a soft option, you know. I remember distinctly when I was about, I wasn't even a teenager, and I said to somebody I was an artist, and he snapped at me, an artist, you piss artist, sort of thing, you know. So that's the usual thing I got, or artist, that, you know, like, totally undervalued. I mean, I came from a farming community, you know. My sort of teenage years, I was in a farming community, really. You know, all the kids at school were farmers' sons and daughters, and they just went straight into farming. You know, the parents' farms, businesses. And so I just felt really out of it, you know, like I didn't belong. And I felt strange because I was so different in what I aspired to. And like I say, I used to get these comments every time. I used to say, you know, this is what I am, you know. Or when I produce something, you know, at school, or some artwork, and people just like grunt at you, like and have a wry grin on their face, you know, as if to say, well, you're so what, you know. That's not going to get you any. That's not going to get you any money, is it? You know that. I've just had it all my life, constantly all my life. You know, a lot of gaining access to the art sort of world is due to circumstance, really. You know, if you think about it, wherever you're born into the place, demographically, you know, it helps, doesn't it? You know, and if you're born into a family that's, you know, already, you know, got some kind of involvement in the arts, then you know you're halfway there. So it's about circumstance and opportunity.
You know, when I was a teenager, like I say, a young teenager growing up in this sort of farming community, sort of working class, you know, I remember we had a huge sort of old rickety garage in the back of the garden where I lived, and I used to go in there and paint. And I remember doing abstract stuff, paintings. But I also used to make things. You know, I used to build these sculptures out of old wood I found. Built really big ones, you know, in this shed. And I went through a phase of doing just completely abstract work. I did about 20 of these abstract paintings. I mean, that was my initial, you know, I was drawing a lot then, but, you know, I started with abstraction. I mean, I did a few sort of realistic sort of drawings as well, you know, but my main, so, you know, I just felt totally, different, really, than everybody else. And there was no opportunity for artists, you know, it just didn't exist. You know, I had to make it happen. When I eventually found out how to actually get to a point where, you know, and one of the best ways, of course, is education, arts education. That's one way into, you know, being seen and heard as an artist. And I've always thought as well, you know, if it is about circumstance and you know, what about the people that, what about the geniuses that have been missed? You know, just because life is what it is, you know, society is what it is. What about the people that it's missed? I've come across people that are fantastic at, you know, absolutely out of this world sort of talent in art or music or something like that, but they're born into a system where it negates all that. And they just end up in some kind of dead-end job for the rest of their lives, and it's just wasted. You know, that's really, it's terrible, terrible. And this idea that art is secondary and not worthy of anything, you know, it's not taught in schools, you know, that the professionalism of art isn't taught in schools, you know, it's not promoted as a professional, you know, as a profession. I mean, there's a lot of reasons for that, but
you know, it stuck with me, that idea. And I think art should be professional. It is a profession. You know, this is this. But there's, you know, even in like society, it's not encouraged. There are ways to make a living out of art, but it's not apparent really. You know, it's not easy to navigate. And especially if you want to be part of the the academic side of things, I think that gives you, affords you some further opportunity for a PhD gives you a voice. You've got something to you can base your work within a theoretical framework, and you can talk about your work extensively and comprehensively in detail, and that's, you know, that in itself is a profession. You know, that's why so many artists go into academia. I'm under no illusions about getting work, gaining employment within academia. You know, the competition is rife. You know, I mean, it's hard. It's a difficult profession to get into. So, but I feel that somewhere along the line, I hope anyway, that somebody's going to give me an opportunity. I've been told that people would be interested, you know, my project. What I have to say about painting. And so, you know, if I can utilize that in some way, either be contracted as a teacher within, a university somewhere, you know, a lecturer, or maybe, because I know that contracts are only short-term contracts, maybe I'll be in the situation where I have to do half and half sort of thing. Percentage of my time would be in teaching in a contract system, and the other half would just be kind of freelance, you know, visiting lecture, in other words. You know, I'd be quite happy doing that. My aim really is to, you know, like any artist really, this is to gain enough financial freedom to be able to produce my work, you know, to gain a studio and produce my work. You look at the cost of studios, you know, and it's not just the studio itself, of course, you know, it's the travelling and everything else. You know, the cost of it is high, so, you know, catch 22. You need the money to be able to practice. And you can only get enough money. You know, you have to work to get the money. So that's why so many people end up in teaching, so many artists end up in teaching, because it's the best way you can actually be part of being as close as you can to art and people producing art. And at the same time, have enough money to fulfill your own practice. It's a good way of doing it, teaching. So that's my plan anyway. But you know, I'm very familiar with how life can throw things, turn things around completely in a negative way. That's potential too. So all you can do is hope, can't you? That's all you can do. Hope for the best. Put yourself in the situation. Gain the qualifications that you need and hope. That's it. Apart from anything else, you know, I'd make a good teacher because, partly because of my knowledge, you know, the practical knowledge of producing a painting, you know, and any media really. I could teach watercolour, acrylic, gouache, tempera, you know, I've tried them all, I've done them all really. And, you know, I could quite easily teach, practical skills, drawing skills. I could do life drawing classes. It's quite extensive, really, what my skill set can offer. Apart from the actual talking about the work, I'm sure somebody somewhere has a need for it. I'm lucky in a way because I've also got skills in graphic design. You know, I could, if there's any crossover needed, you know, I could do a sort of lesson in graphic design. I could do a number of extensive long-term lessons in graphic design. I could teach illustration. I could teach a whole a year's work of illustration, if need be. I can cross over. Have had industry experience with both of those, graphic design and illustration. painting's my true love. The go-to thing whenever I need to relieve any creative tension. This is just one particular style of painting. You know, an artist really should have the facility to be able to diversify. You know, think about one of the main attributes of being an artist is your imagination. All it takes is imagination, creativity, to be able to do, you know, produce any style really that's you called to do. You know, it shouldn't be limited by style. You know, I'm not getting at Picasso, right? But you know, his, you know, he went from one style to the next. People called him a genius, but really, all he's doing is just utilizing his creative imagination, you know. Nothing, that's just a normal thing for an artist. You know, I've said it before, but you know, I've covered every conceivable style in my lifetime. Remember that garage I was telling you about when I was a boy? Well, I remember Picasso was a big influence at that point in my life. And I remember completing this, I called it the depressed man in a wooden chair. It was an oil painting, about this high, Picasso-esque style. It was only on wood, it wasn't on canvas, just on a piece of old wood that I found, but I did it in oil paint. And then, like I say, I went through it. I don't know where that went and where that ended up. I have no clue. Lost it. But I did a number of those types of... did a few of them, actually, at that time. When I did an abstract painting for my O-level work. Thank you.
I was quite an eccentric teenager. An example of that is I used to be really sort of be in this sort of romantic sort of bubble, reading about especially the impressionists and things. And I remember going on long walks in the summer on my own into the countryside. And I remember distinctly sitting in this long grass in the heat of the sun and smoking a pipe. And I must have been all of 15, you know, 14, 15. Puffing away on this pipe, sort of dreaming. At school, they used to call me Nutty Hogan because he just didn't understand me, really. You know, it was completely different to the normal. You know, I wasn't playing football and, you know, fighting and climbing trees. I was just different, you know, my whole mindset was different. You know, I stood out like a sore thumb in the farming community. You know, they just didn't understand me. You know, I've always been quite vocal, you know, and I'd say things and they'd just look, grin at me like as if I was like I was an alien or something. It's just my creativity, you know. Right, these are police lights. It's obviously fantasy because, you know, where's the electric supply coming from? There isn't one, so, you know, artistic license again. But, I wanted to give them some kind of, you know, luminosity and some, as if they're flashing, you know, the impression of flashing. So I want to, so I'm going to go for a very light carillion blue over the top. See, I put a lot of white in underneath. So when I put this glaze of blue on top, we'll pick the white. The white will come through underneath, and hopefully, well, according to my plan anyway, it should give it some kind of luminosity as if it's flashing. So I'll do a very thin glaze of this carillion over the top of the white in certain areas, leaving some of the white underneath. So I'll try it.
a bit out perhaps here and there. The idea. Obviously they're all going to be different. Some may be more successful than others. Say maybe another leave that to dry, and maybe another layer on top might do it. In the meantime, I'm going to do what. These faces need some work again, but got to that note, so. Put some whites now to highlight a bit. Thank you. bit on the brush. It's a middle bit. That's where the flash is coming from. Extreme with the top bit though. Hear the siren noise in my head as I'm doing this. Really getting there, they're sort of semi looking like they're flashing now, I think. Let's do these. Ties.
Hello. Right, I've so from the top figures there around this area, around the bottom, I've added another layer. So I've just got this area here now for the third layer. I've made a few alterations as I've gone along. This central figure here, it's a reference to you know, my work's multicultural, so, and has a historical aspect to it as well. So I use episodes from the past intermingled with the present as well. That's this figure here, I've decided it's the basis of it at the moment. You can't actually, it's not finished yet, but I've decided to they're on fire, but just the head is on fire, right? So the face is burnt and you know, ash and all the rest of it. The reason I've done that is because it's referencing the, I remember on the news when I was quite young, seeing on the news something about the atrocities in China at the time, or China, I think it was, the Tiananmen Square atrocities. And there was one particular related to that. I think it was later on, I'm not entirely sure, but all I remember seeing on the news, I think it was a picture of a young man kneeling down in a public area, pouring petrol on himself and setting fire to himself in protest. So that is a reference to that type of thing. I mean, there's been many other episodes in the past, but that's particularly stuck in my mind, and because it was so such a horrible image. And that's the extent of, you know, the people will protest. So, you know, they'll put their lives, you know, take their own lives in protest. So that's the strength of it. So that's what that signifies. Yeah. I mean, I might find others as I go. But like I say, I'm going to do this icon, fur icon here now, the exterior of it. Deep orange. Some of these motion lines around here so it stands out. Orange.
necessarily see a shadow there, really, so I'm going to get rid of that, probably. Diffuse some of that. In line with a shiny surface. Smoke from that. With some lighter tone again. This is a lot of yellow in this time. There might be some reflection of that flame on there as well. So really I'm just reinforcing what's already there, but I'm also picking out where all the lights occur at the same time. When I find one, I'll accentuate that. But when I go in with the white colours, the white highlights, Oops, caught his leg. Blue in there. No, I was talking about my skill set a couple of days ago, and what I can offer as a teacher, as a stroke sort of lecturer, and I mentioned the children's books and the graphic design, and I have had industry experience. Well, the children's books I've written and illustrated three of my own children's books. I think two of them at least are on a link from my website. I tried numerous ways to get them published, but I just found it really difficult, and so I gave up in the end, because I just thought, well, if you don't want what I've got, then forget it, you know. Anyway, but one of them was an actual client job, a commission. It took me 2 months to do. He'd written the book, and he gave me the text, and I illustrated it. And like I say, I did a draft, some draft illustrations, and then I did them properly. It was successful, you know. It was just at the time when COVID was coming in, when I finished it. He paid me, thank God, just before it happened. And then he told me, he sent me an email a few weeks later saying it had been published, but he never sent me the link. I did ask him for it, but he didn't. So it is published somewhere. What was it called again? A Caveman Discovers Fire. Anyway, I forgot the name of him now. I think it was Jack. He changed the name a few times anyway. But I've illustrated three of my own books. One of them's halfway finished, and the other two I actually completed. I wrote them and illustrated them. One was called Granny Cake, and the other one was called Little Jack's Big Adventure. sake, to have a look. They're on the link on the website. And graphic design wise, you know, my degree was in graphic design, although I specialised in illustration at the time. I've actually also done an MA in animation, so I've got animation skills as well. I did 18 months of it, you know, so I utilise the technology. Technology to complete it. So I've covered most bases, really. You know, graphic design wise, you know, I've done book covers, I've done client work for multinational work for clients. Even though I've done graphic design, and it's not my most favourite thing to do, but I can turn my hand to it at any time, really. So you see, great number of skills. Anything to do with art, it's just in this country we just don't seem to have any kind of resource for it, really. I mean, there's galleries and stuff. But I mean specifically about like help for artists. You know, this in British society, they don't hold art in any kind of regard, you know. And it shows in the education system. It's not encouraged, like I say, you know, saying about, you know, all the sciences that are encouraged. You know, a lot of the humanities are encouraged, you know. But art hasn't got the same credence. It's not viewed as in the same way. I think that's a travesty. It's to the British culture. You know, I mean, we've in this country we have some of the leaders of, you know, of art and artists. Some of the greats of art in this country. And when it comes to the basic sort of facility for engaging with artists and helping them and assisting them and all the rest of it, it's just non-existent. Unless you go to some kind of, college in high esteem, like one of the
London universities or something. You know, that when you come out of them, you're actually famous before you even leave the place. But it's that thing again, isn't it? Those who have and those who have not. Circumstance. Where you live, you know, demographics. See a bit more light there. I must get this right here. Leave it alone. Cause there'll be some. Do this his nose again. A lot deeper red this time. Picking out those colours underneath. Shiny. Thank you.
keeps altering until I get it right, until I think that it's good enough. Some more whites in. Have a go. For the shadows, I'm going to go a wet into wet technique, so that colour underneath already. I'm going to put some, use the same red to go in there. Keep that lip. May go darker yet in the fourth layer, but as long as I get rudiments in, really. Dark shadow under there. His eye a bit better. Picked up some blue there. Not rough. Redefine his smile. His eye in. I can go a lot darker in tone on his eye now. then I go back in with the white again. This is where I'll be picking out all the highlights. Redefining areas. Again. Because I've put that very light yellow in there, I'm going to put a white against that now. It's you'll see what it does to the yellow. It helps if you don't pick any of the yellow up as you go in. This is why you need to go in a fourth time, really, to let things dry so you can get a really crisp this is really what I do with the fourth layer. It's crisping everything up, defining everything sharp, which is the way I like it. I mean, if you look at my work, you know, in reality, in real life, you look at the brushwork, it's actually very minimal and very minimal expressionistic, really. You know, I'm not going in with tiny little brushes a lot of the time. It's really almost impressionistic. Trying to create the roundness of this ear, really. Get that really crisp light there. I have to wait for it to dry. Go over it again. But get the basic idea there now. And what I tend to do is, as I'm doing something else, I suddenly see something and I just put a dash of colour on or something. I quite often do that. Let's get his face in here now. There's all sorts of reflections in there. Plastic, isn't it? Smoke. I'll have to do that flame. I haven't done any of this yet. I'll have to do is the bottle and that. Into this nose as well. Yeah. Can pick out the blue. Some stupid reason. Actually, more. A few issues there anyway. Get there eventually. Just a case of keep working into it. You find what you're happy with. Eye. Redefine that a bit more. There's a reflection that I like, I'm going to keep that. Some of the blue in there as well I like. I guess I'll just put some up there. And a highlight there, and a highlight there. And I think probably join that up. Use it a bit. Anyway, it's just it's the rest of it down the bottom there. In there. too fussy. Not just enough. Oil paint attracts dust like nobody's business. Everything wants to stick to it. Like that, I think. It's getting there now. I'm just like I say, next time round. I'll go in again. That's better than it was, anyway. There's a sort of shadow in here. Mind your head. Let's strengthen that up a bit. It can be rough in there, really.
Yeah, so I'm just going to pick out the sort of salient points, and I really like the light here, so I'm going to try and keep hold of that. Expression in her eyes, I think. And again, see, I approach every figure in a different way usually. You know, they're not all the same, everyone's unique. You know, it just depends where they are within the picture. And what they are in relation to everything else. You know, in some of my work, I actually just leave it at its rudimentary stage, you know, sort of one or two layers, you know, very quick, hardly any detail, I'll just leave it. You know, in some ways that it's better that way. You know, these are sort of in the background, these figures, so there's not a, you know, there's less emphasis, so it can be less, there can be less detail, really. That's the idea, anyway. And I like that hand the way it is, for instance. I might do a bit extra on it. Just reinforce some of those blues there. Because I like the way this flames. You know, I have applied to countless galleries in the past, and most of them don't even reply. You know, and they've got the reasons for that, but you know, I haven't literally have never had a reply that. Giving me some kind of guidance or anything, you know. Which I just think that's courteous, you know. It's what I mean about no kind of. If it doesn't fit into the, you know, clientele. What their clientele wants, and that seems to be the guidelines, really. I understand now that the
best way to, rather than emails, you know, which generally doesn't get you anywhere, I've realised now that a better way around is to contact, is to find the names of the curators. Approach them, because if you can get in with a curator, then you know it's half the battle. Because I mean, this is about exhibitions, really, you know, rather than galleries. But you know, going forward, this is what I'll be certainly be doing after the PhD. I'll be approaching curators, instead, and hopefully I'll have a bit more success that way.
I think that's about as far as I want to go with these figures here. That's all that's really required.
Tempted to always go in with these, you know, there's a lot of this I can fix in the next layer. When it's dry. I tend to do things as I go as well. This is waiting for drying times.
Do this figure now. We'll start with his noddy hat, I think. Thank you.
has a few of them with the noddy hats. But as I said before about the strength of tone in relation to the position of the person in the picture. This person is before these people, you know, in front of. So this particular muddy hat can be darker in tone compared to those. Never lost these brushes. is here in it. I should tie things up. Cocked. And around this sort of area, we're picking too much of that red up. sure about these lights here on top of this. Maybe I'll keep it there. So that's some kind of movement in there.
Hello. Yeah, so This is Friday now, so I've completed most of it, the third layer, and I'm just concentrating now on this area that I've got to complete today, because it's Friday and I've got a whole bank holiday. Yippee. Can't stand bank holidays. But anyway, for 3 days I've got to stay off, right, so back on Tuesday. So I've got to finish this today, the third layer, so I can start again on Tuesday, on the fourth layer, the fourth and final layer, hopefully. So this is it today. Okay, so I'm going to do this guy, the central fella first, and I've already got the paint sorted out. I'm going to do him a lot darker red here. You know, because obviously I want to go into teaching at university. When I first started this PhD, I asked them if I could get as much experience as I could doing just that experience. So, to gain experience, I've been doing, I've completed so far, some oil painting workshops, which went well. I had about 30 people in the group. And there's a prospect for some more this year. I've done group talks where there's about 40 people in the gallery space downstairs, BA and MA students. And that was really about my practice and an explanation of the work that was on display. And I've also done a seminar where I've done presentations satire and on my practice. So I want to do as many as I can of these things. So, you know, I've got a lot more planned for the coming year and the last sort of 18 months of the PhD.
But, you know, it's a case of being proactive, isn't it? You know, I want to be, I don't want to just be proficient at these things. I want to be brilliant at them. That's my goal. And so, you know, you obviously need as much experience as you can get to extend your skill base. This course in particular has been particularly good for that, I think. I don't think I think there's only one other PhD that's here at the moment. But I'm the only painter. So I've had a lot of good feedback. I've got a lot of further exhibitions planned. There's one in particular at Preston bus station, which is coming up. Because there's a high footfall at the bus station there, and it's the particular social group really that I'm interested in finding their reactions to my work. That's something I can record in some way. Obviously that helps my PhD really. That should be this year now, coming up. Hopefully about March next year, maybe. But I've got another one. It's a small exhibition for some different occupations within UCLan. I've got a couple of cleaners, a couple of security guards, facilities. What I'm trying to do is just gain some feedback from the sort of people that I believe would have an interest in my work, in the sense that you know, the contentious issues and trying to measure sort of relationality. So I mean, this is just a starting sort of enterprise. You know, I will obviously further exhibitions will just be for, there won't be any specific demographic of you know, people, but they'll just a general population really. But you know, I'll let you know on Facebook as I get these things done. I'll post my report soon as well when that comes back. My report from the transfer report. So I'm in the process of that at the moment still. When it's finished, I'll post it on Facebook. Well, on my blog. I'm very open about my practice. I want it to be accessible, and I want people to engage with it. You know, good and bad.
Okay, so if, this figure's about as far as I probably go now until the next layer. So I'm going to do these two now, hopefully before dinner time. If not, then maybe afterwards. So, I think I'll do this one first. And he's, although he's got purple, he's quite purple at the moment. I don't, I think I may go, I don't know, maybe purple, I'll stay with that. You know, I said I'm bequeathing this painting to UCLan when I've finished. I mean, I'm not entirely sure yet, but it's probably going to be the case. If I do, then there's I've found the place it could go. And I'm going to suggest it to him when I get to that point. there's a sort of student's recreational type of hall. Within the complex of the university, and it, people go in there, you know, to play games and eat food and relax and all the rest of it. And, it's got huge, it's a really modern building. It hasn't long been since it was built. It's got really high ceilings, and there's a particular part of it, like there's a huge big expanse of wall space, which I think this painting could easily fit. Bags under his eyes, I think this guy. His eyes need to be a bit bigger. Anyway. Strengthened some of these areas up here with the light. Just in there. Of course, this writing would probably have some up lighting on it now as well.
be one there for the red one. One there for the white, for the orange one. You can go too far. Okay, so I'm going to do this figure now. But I'm already aware that this arm here is probably too thick, so I'm going to reduce that. Oops. Whoops. Same with everything though, when you make changes, you have to repair what's behind it. So most of it is wall, which is not a good sign really. Also, and what's there's his shoulder there, so his forearm or probably his sort of bicep are probably more likely to be there really. So I'll put it there. Also, I think that I should shorten this too, so the cuff a bit more there. Get the orange one in first. They all need work, all of this needs work.
was really. So just see where his hand is there, sort of. Clutching the skull. Trigger. So I'm gonna be three fingers. That's why you put that there. It's the uplight, isn't it? So you probably notice layer three, you know, there's a, what I've done already, it's a bit vague and a bit not quite finished off yet, and that's what layer four is about. So, you know, I'm building on top, and as soon as I get to a point where it's finished, which is usually layer four or layer five, it all comes together. So I keep building into it until it arrives at the place I want it to arrive at. Got a really big chin, but I don't mind. I like some of that, I don't mind that. There's certain things you can't do until it's dry, really.
so they can go in once again. Sort it out. Looking better anyway. So I'm going to do his top here now. More darker version of the Viridian that's already there, really. Of this expansive sort of up light here, so some movement in from the guy on this person here, movement lines. It's dinner time already. It doesn't look like I'm going to get these finished today. In fact, I know I'm not going to. Next time around. Work to do to get them completed. You know, you just do it in your own time, and there's no rush. I don't know why I'm rushing anyway. I think it's because I'm trying to get them. Well, why? Why am I trying to get it done? No need. Plenty of time to finish it. I think it's something my lecturer said to me. I don't need to. Go at my own pace, and when it's finished, it's finished. I mean, this is a lot of canvas to fill, you know. It's a lot of work. Happy with those over there, are they? It's all detail in the final, in the fourth layer, really. Anyway, I need a break, so I'm gonna leave it there. Dinner time. I think once I've had a sandwich, a bit of a relax for half an hour, I should come back and do that one. How oil paint grows legs and walks off. Right? You find it in your hair and everything, all over your face, everywhere. Right? Give you an example of it. You go to the toilet and you wash your hands, right? And you just glance in the mirror and you think nothing's there, right? So you just glance, there's nothing there on your face, you know, no paint. Yeah. Got all the way home yesterday, looking in the fridge for something in the supermarket, glanced at my reflection for a split second and realised there was a big blob of white paint all the way down, all around this area here, big blob of it. Like thick white paint. I wonder why I was getting a lot of strange looks. But when I was here, I didn't see it. It just suddenly appeared. It does, it follows you. It grows legs and follows you. Anyway, what was I doing? I was doing this guy's balloon, wasn't I? Man's balloon. Now, why is that covered in blue? Right. So this is the only blue balloon. This is sort of a glaze, really. Some of that I like, some tricky, some of that. I've put some white highlights in there. It should be about right that way. I'm going to put one there. What I'm going to do, I'm going to put a line around these here because in readiness for that got the white lining. And also here on his hair. Plus it shows a bit of movement anyway. What was I doing yet? So that's the yellow one there, which is there too. I needed an edge there, so there it is. There's supposed to be one there, like. Do the blue one now. Actually, look here. I've got the line there. I need one around this one here. Look as well. Just so that when I get that man behind him in, I've already got a line there to work from. It's not quite good enough there. What's going on? In readiness. Just so it's there ready. And I really have to put one also in there. Okay. So that's not quite right. Thank you. carried away. There's just this blue balloon. Some orange there I want to get rid of. That sort of looks like it's been twisted around there. Side here. Successful. And I'll be one in the middle too. No, it's not to say there won't be any more going in, it's just this is, I keep repeating myself, this is the third layer. Room for improvement. So I'm going to do this bottle that he's clutching. It's further away than the other bottles, so sort of keep it light at first. This wall is probably going to be a lot deeper blue than that. And also this fun land, I've just got the base layer down there at the moment. It's going to be a lot redder in tone. Lots of highlights, and it's going to be like dripping paint, so there's going to be reflections in it and stuff. But anyway, let's get this bottle roughly in here. A bit of that. there's lots of obviously reflections and all sorts in glass. It's the same with the others. What I've been doing is just adding to them as I've been going along, really. Until they arrive at a point.
Hello, well, this is level three now, layer three, I should say. When I get to this stage, usually, I mean, sometimes I add extra elements, as I go, sometimes. Other times I get to sort of this sort of level, and it's better when I get to this level and stop then, because if I don't, then there's a lot of demolition to do, and I don't like doing that, really. I mean, I've already started some demolition, and it's not pleasant. So everything has had a third layer now. And you'll see it's got a slightly darker in tone, the next layer, the final fourth layer, is when I really go in strong with the secondary colours, and I develop the figures further. Well, everything further, really. But you'll notice the background will become progressively darker again. Everything will. I usually start again at the sky and work down. So I've added a few extra elements as I've gone, like I say. I've added, what I've done is I've added a protagonist of the Yes campaign who happens to be downtrodden he's at a loss anyway, even though he has his partaking in the Yes Brigade. So he's got a tattoo on his neck there, right? I've added sunglasses to this sort of teenager here, shades. Right? I've also dislocated him, so he's going to have a dislocation there, and one there, and one there. When all the background's in, you'll see it better. And I've given this figure, this young boy, glasses. I've also put a 13 that you can partially see on the back of his jumper, or whatever it is, jacket, whatever. Like I say, I'll keep putting things in as I sort of think of them, really, along with, you know, progressing the painting. But I mean, I know for sure that this wall's going to change. I'm unsure as yet whether or not to keep it a blue colour or to go with a true brick colour, you know, a sort of sienna colour, really. But I'm not sure, because I wanted that funland
graffiti to stand out, really, really stand out. So it does with the blue, but if I make it, you know, brick colour, then it will get lost a bit. And I mean, even though I'm going to put some sort of highlights on there, because it's supposed to be sort of semi-wet paint sort of thing, but it's high gloss paint, so it's going to have some gloss to it. So I don't know, I'm in two minds. I mean, it'll certainly change the painting if I make it brick colour again, so I'm not sure. It might just go a lot darker blue, I don't know, until I get to it, really. But what I will do is I'll start at the top again, like I say, and this final layer is where I define everything and make sure everything's up to the right sort of level. But then, you know, later on, you know, even a year down the line, I might say, see something and say, oh yeah, that can be changed. I don't know. So, I mean, you know, you just go along with it. And does it say what I want it to say? Well, I think it does. I'm not entirely, you know, there's a few things I could have done better. I could have realised it in a different way. I could have, but, you know, for what it is, I think it says what it says, effectively. Anyway, so the next video will be the fourth layer video where I finish it. Okay, thank you.